Prime Minister, this week your government announced a state of emergency over power supplies, the worst trade figures in our history, and a sudden credit squeeze. Isn't this the most severe crisis you've had to face since becoming Prime Minister?
We've had a number of difficult decisions to take while we've been the government and difficult situations to deal with. We've had a number in Ireland, for example, and 18 months ago we had to deal with a problem of the pound, and on each occasion we have taken decisions firmly and speedily and dealt with the situation. We floated the pound, it saved our reserves, we still have very large reserves. This week we had a difficult situation to deal with, a combination of factors. First of all, the trade figures. Secondly, the not working overtime in the coal mines. Thirdly, a world problem of oil. And, as I've said, we dealt decisively with it. But I'm very glad to be able to talk to you tonight about it, because these are major factors in the national situation as well as the international situation. And I want everybody in this country to understand everything about them. So I'm delighted to talk to you.
But with all these coming together, it does seem a particularly gloomy time that we're in for at this moment.
Well, let us look at the trade figures to begin with. This was obviously a distorted month. There were certain factors, in particular the Middle East war, which affected it. We have a very big trade in diamonds. Large amount of diamonds came in, none went out, because a lot normally go to Israel, and the war was on. We also took delivery of a very large amount of shipping, some £45 million worth more than normal. And we also took in a great deal of fuel. Well, the reason for that's obvious. Everybody has been stocking up, and this is obviously useful in this present situation. But it did mean a very big adverse balance of trade. Now, what we have to do is to get exports going up still further. But one of the interesting and important things is, and we've got to keep this in perspective, that for the first time since the end of the war, our exports over the past year have increased faster than world trade itself. Now, this is very important, and it does mean that our industrialists, everybody working in industry, whether it's management or workers, have in most cases done a tremendous job. And what we want above everything now is more production.
But if I can pick you up on imports, we're likely to have a lot of imports, heavy prices to pay for imports, especially oil, in the future. You're not blaming Israeli diamonds for the worst ever figures.
Now let's discuss this seriously. I was dealing with one particular month's trade figures. I said, if you're going to look at the course of trade now over the coming year, we are in a very powerful position from the point of view of exports, because up and down the country, industrialists are telling me that they have very large export orders, which will keep them going for a long time ahead. You see, we have now become very competitive in world markets. Again, more competitive than we've been at any time since the end of the last war. And our industrialists will tell you that they can now undercut anywhere in the world with their products. And so this makes our export position very strong.
And our import position that much weaker, because we're paying more for imports.
We are paying more for imports, and we have to recognize that the oil-producing countries have suddenly made an enormous increase in the price of oil. They're in a position to do this because there is, over the world as a whole, a growing shortage of energy. Given time, we shall be in a very strong position again. Because when North Sea oil begins to come through, I hope in the end of 74 and certainly in good proportions in 1975, we can then look forward towards the end of the decade, towards 1980, when we shall be producing a very considerable proportion of the oil we require ourselves, and we shall be at the beginning of a new period of nuclear energy production. And so it is this interim period which we have to deal with.
Can I bring you back to the state of emergency? Was the announcement of the state of emergency time to draw attention away from the disastrous trade figures and the financial crisis?
The purpose of taking emergency powers was to be able to safeguard the life of the community. We have this unfortunate situation, and nobody regrets it more than I do, where overtime is not now being worked in the mines. You may recall that 2 years ago we had the miners' strike. At that time, the government was criticized for not taking emergency powers, which would enable us to harbor our resources for as long as possible, not taking those powers early enough. Now, we have learnt from the past. We are not making that mistake again. Meantime, we have built up our coal stocks over this past year very substantially. We've built up our oil stocks very substantially. But of course, that can be affected by the present oil situation in the producing countries. But it is our duty as a government to be prudent, to look ahead for the country as a whole, and conserve the different forms of energy which we've got. Taking the emergency powers on Tuesday enables us to do this.
But didn't we have a crisis last week with the miners? Why didn't you take emergency powers before the by-elections rather than wait until there'd only been one day of the miners' overtime ban and then you took them?
Because the miners' overtime ban started on Monday, it did not start last week, and the miners and leaders themselves said when they started the overtime ban that it would be very effective very quickly. In actual fact, each day in this week, we've lost about 20% of our coal production. The NCB's figures, which they've given me, are that they think they've lost about a fifth of their production each day so far this week. Now, if maintenance is not done on Saturday and Sunday, I understand it means that maintenance will have to be done on Monday next week in those pits which are not permanently affected. That means another day's production gone and overtime on the other days. And so it will become progressively steeper.
But with 13
million tons,
it's therefore
prudent for us to harbour everything in order to keep our industry going so that we can fulfil our export orders, and that ties up, of course, with the balance of payments.
But with 13 million tons of coal in stock and 11 weeks' supply for electricity, isn't it a rather drastic measure to cut off heating to children in schools, for example?
We are making a change on the position of children in schools. We were proposing to do it under the emergency powers by issuing administrative licences for those places which required them. We've decided this evening that it's better to exempt schools and places of education, technical college and so on, from the order. So that will enable schools to have heating. But we do appeal to them to make a voluntary saving. I think probably everybody in this country would agree that if we really set our minds to it, we could all economize and save in various ways. In the government, we've issued an order to all government establishments. We've also asked local authorities, other institutions, and so on, to make an economy of at least 10%, so that the government is immediately doing its part as well.
Can I bring you to the miners now? The Home Secretary says the miners' intention is to break the government. Do you believe their action is political? They want to smash
I very much hope it isn't. For any section of the community to say that they're going to confront the government, and in fact they are confronting Parliament, because what the government is carrying out on its incomes policy is under an act passed by Parliament and under code, the code for stage three, approved by Parliament. And so it would be a direct challenge to not only to government, but to Parliament itself. And so I hope the miners don't say that. It is true
Mr.
that...
Mr. Carr is saying this.
No, it is true that Mr. Gormley, the miners' leader, said at the time that their argument was not with the NCB. They were, at that time, not accepting the National Coal Board's offer because it was in line with government policy. Well, it isn't only government policy. It is an act of Parliament and a code which has been passed by Parliament. But, you know, again, if you look back 2 years after the last miners' strike, when I appeared on television and spoke to the nation, I said that surely everybody must agree that we must find a more sensible way of settling our differences. This had damaged the country, it had reduced our production, it had almost brought the country to a standstill. The miners themselves lost a large amount in wages, which it took them a very long time to make up. And I don't really believe that miners enjoy being on strike and holding up production and
so
on.
But they're leaving the pits at the rate of 600 a week, Mr. Heath.
Yes, but you know,
how are you going to keep them at the pits?
Well, you know, it's very interesting. That figure went up above the 600 after it had been announced that the miners were proposing to take industrial action. Now, doesn't this suggest to you that, in fact, there are a lot there who don't want to see their wages going down because overtime is stopped, let alone to lose wages, because it's a strike.
Are you suggesting if there were a strike ballot, the miners would be against striking?
I'm not going to prophesy what would happen if there were to be a ballot. That is a matter for the miners themselves to settle. They have their own machinery of the ballot. They are perfectly entitled to use it. And no, they will vote freely if they have it. That is entirely a matter for the miners. But I want to return to my point that I said we must find a more reasonable way of settling our differences, prevent damage to the country, prevent damage to the coal industry, prevent damage to the miners themselves. And that is what we have set out quite deliberately to do, to find a more sensible way.
It
was that June, if you look back, that I started the talks at Chequers with the trade unions and with the employers. We've carried those on. The last group of talks I had, 33.25 hours I spent in talking with the representatives of the unions and with the employers. And I have myself seen the whole of the miners' negotiating committee and explained everything to them. We've done our utmost to find a more reasonable way of settling our differences.
Why do they want more money then? And why can't they be convinced that this is a just policy?
Well, I hope that it will be possible to convince them.
How?
Because we shall go on explaining to them what not only a reasonable but a very generous offer this is under phase three. And in addition to that, we can come back to that again in a moment, if you like. In addition to that, we've committed as a government the taxpayers' money to the extent of £1,100 million in the coal industry, £1,100 million in this past year. And it was after that that Mr. Gormley said, we can now see security in the coal industry.
It's been suggested, Prime Minister, that you're confronting the miners.
He also said, but of course we miners have to produce the goods when they're required, and this is the moment when they are required.
It's being suggested that you're taking on the miners, Prime Minister.
Don't say that again, please.
That you can blame them for the financial crisis and the threat to power supply.
There is absolutely no question of taking on the miners. The offer which has been made to them under stage three is a very generous offer. It is, in fact, going to regain some of the place which they say they have lost since their award of 2 years ago. But what is important for them is this, that under the code, here is a reasonable and fair way of dealing with wage problems. And it does mean that if the miners accept their award, they're not going to find somebody else come and leapfrog over them, because that's not possible under the code.
It does
enable them to protect their position, which is what they say they wish to do.
If it comes to a deadlock between the miners and the government, would you be willing to hold an election on the issue? Who runs the country, the miners or the government?
I don't deal with hypothetical questions. All my energies are devoted to persuading the miners that the offer which is being made to them by the National Coal Board under stage three is one which is made under a law and a code passed by Parliament and which gives them a very generous arrangement. After all, they are being offered by the Coal Board 13%. Now, this means that nobody...
Not all of them are being offered 13%.
Well, the total pool is 13%. Now, let me make this point. There is plenty of scope within that total for the coal miners themselves to negotiate. If they wish the lower paid miners to have proportionately more than the higher paid miners, they can do this. They can negotiate it. This is what we've been talking to the unions about for these past months, to give them the utmost opportunity and flexibility to negotiate. Now, under the present offer to them, those miners at the higher end of the scale who are getting £50 a week, the offer may amount to £10 a week more. Well, if they wish to negotiate that is less and others lower down get more, this can be done with the National Coal Board.
In addition to that offer,
they can have an efficiency scheme which will bring them in an additional 3 to 3.5%. That too they can negotiate. Now, isn't all of this very reasonable?
Well, I'd like to bring you on to the economy, if I may. Do the credit squeeze and the raising of interest rates you announced this week mean that all the brave words about growth and going for growth are over and we're back to the old routine of stop-go and that this is stop?
This growth is going to continue. Our problem at the moment, I said the other day, is a problem of success. And our difficulty is that over these past years, going back a long way now in this country, 20 years or more, we have not had the investment which would give us new plant and new machinery. Now, I have mentioned that so many of our industrialists today could sell much more abroad than they are able to produce. I summed it up last week at the speech at the Albert Hall by saying the problem used to be to sell what they can make. Today the problem is to make what they can sell.
Does the city believe this, Mr. Heath? Today there was panic selling and 1,000 million was knocked off of shares. Do you think that they are convinced that they should invest and that things are rosy?
I know that industrialists are convinced. Of this I am quite sure. And when they see the export order books which they've got, they know that they've just got to go on producing to the maximum. And, management, in many cases, can get more production by using its wits, really. But I put it just as plainly as that.
Do high interest rates, making borrowing very expensive, does that encourage investment?
Yes, but industrialists take this over a longer term, a much longer term. We had a period in 71, 72, when there were lower interest rates, and they didn't invest. They have now decided to invest. And investment may take 2 years, up to five years, up to 10 years in some cases. Certainly in the nationalized industries, up to 10 years. And they take a longer view, and that, I believe, is what they're going to do now. We took these measures on Tuesday in order to show people that where there was too much credit, it was going to be reduced, and this will enable much more to go into exports.
The city don't obviously believe that you've finished with the package. There are talks tonight that there will be another budget with income tax and petrol tax.
These rumors sweep the city from time to time. I don't know who brings them,
Will you deny that there will be a further package of measures?
This has already been denied in the House of Commons this afternoon.
There will be no increase in personal taxation?
What was said this afternoon was there's not going to be an autumn budget, and let us be quite clear about that.
But will there be an increase in personal taxation?
Well, I've said there will not be an autumn budget. I would have thought you'd have realised that if you're going to do that sort of thing, you have to have budgets. But I don't know where these rumours start from. What has happened is that we have dealt with this situation. Sterling has been stable since Tuesday when we dealt with it. And the important thing now, I come back to it again and again and again, is to get production. Now, this is where industrial relations come in, and where the possibility of going slow or not doing overtime, let alone having strikes, is so damaging to us at this moment. This is a government which has committed itself to expansion. And I believe from all my talks with the trade union leaders that what they want above everything is expansion. Because they know that the only real way in which they can get a better standard of living for their members is by having expansion. After all, we've got unemployment down more than 300,000.
Will that increase with higher interest rates?
Well, there is a great demand for labour at this moment, a very great demand.
And this squeeze really will not affect it?
I believe that growth is going on and we are going to get all the production we possibly can. But take the situation of cars. I'm told that over these past 10 months we've lost 400,000 cars out of our production through industrial unrest. 400,000 cars. Now that in itself could make a tremendous contribution to demand for cars on the home market, instead of importing whatever it may be, Japanese or European. And it would also help us enormously with our exports. And of course, the other thing is that when people overseas who are buying things from us and ordering things from us read that there's going to be some sort of go slow or there's going to be an overtime ban or something like this, they begin to have doubts as to when their deliveries are going to come. And this again was why on Tuesday, the action we took, which was very firm, showed them that we were determined to conserve the energy resources of this country to the utmost in order to keep our industry going, which is a top priority, and so meet our export obligations.
During the Middle East war, we carried out a policy, some would say, of appeasement to the Arabs to safeguard oil supplies. Aren't those oil supplies safe? Can you guarantee them for the
winter? The first part of your question, as you know, is quite untrue. There was no appeasement of any kind. This British government's policy has remained exactly the same towards the Middle East all the time we've been in power. It was defined by the Foreign Secretary, Sir Alec Douglas Hume, as long ago as September 1970, just a few months after we came into office, in what is now a very famous speech which he made at Harrogate. We have not changed from that in any respect at all, and no Arab country has asked us to change from it. As far as the oil supplies are concerned, they have said that they don't want the supplies to Britain to be affected. But of course, what we have to realize is that part of our oil supplies come from companies outside this country who also have contracts to suppliers all over the world. And these oil companies are finding that they can't get all they need. And the result is that they are saying to all their customers, including us, we are only going to be able to give you such and such a proportion of your normal share. And so we are affected by oil companies outside this country whose general oil take is being affected.
Is petrol rationing inevitable, given the fact that the Arab countries are cutting back?
What we are doing is, again, being prudent. And after all, the planning has been done for this over a long time.
How long, Prime Minister?
Oh, well, years. We've seen...
For petrol rationing?
Oh, yes. I mean, petrol coupons have been held in stock and printed and held in stock by successive governments for a very long time. We make contingency plans. You never know when there might be an outbreak of war in the Middle East, or oil be affected by some world event or other. And so a government has to have contingency plans, be wise, make plans for the future. What we have done is to bring the whole of these plans to a higher state of readiness, so that if we do decide that the outlook is so uncertain, then we shall be able to act. And administratively, it always takes a certain amount of time for coupons to be dealt with, for those who have special arrangements to be made, like doctors and so on, to get their special arrangements. And so we brought ourselves to the highest state of readiness. Now, I hope the country will agree that this is prudent.
Could you foresee petrol rationing this winter?
I'm not going to commit myself tonight specifically to petrol rationing at any particular time, because it does depend upon the general outlook. What we have to do is to look at our energy resources as a whole. We have to look at coal, and we have to look at oil, as well as the products of oil, and petrol and Caligas and so on and so forth. Now, obviously, if the miners show that they are prepared to negotiate further with the NCB, say, on the makeup of what is allowed within stage three, and the ban is removed, and our coal production goes on, we are then in a stronger position as far as our total energy resources is concerned than if this overtime ban goes on. So one has to take it all together.
Along with the financial crisis and the energy crisis, there is still the problem of food prices, Prime Minister, and a 19% increase, for example, in the past year. Is there any
there
hope
is the
that
problem
the housewife...
of prices as a whole.
Yes, but is there any hope that the housewife can see an end to dearer and dearer shopping baskets, or are we now in an era when food is just going to be very expensive indeed, when indeed the 15p loaf will make its appearance in due course?
We are on bread and in biscuits and in other ways greatly affected, of course, by the world prices of cereals. And everybody who is concerned with wheat and so on, and also with feeding stuffs for animals, has to place their orders a considerable way ahead. What is proving to be fortunate this autumn is that countries which have suffered badly in the past, the Soviet Union and China in particular, from poor harvests, have this year had good harvests, and most countries in the world have had a good harvest, and so have we. But this will take time before it makes its impact on world prices as a whole. But there is the hope there that stabilization, and then we shall see a decline in the price of cereals. And this will then work its way through into those items which are particularly affected. Of course, at this time of the year, we're now affected by seasonal prices, as every housewife knows. These are sometimes reflected in the index, like tomatoes. But then most people fully recognize that in the winter you can't expect to eat the same quantity of tomatoes as you do in the summer. I mean, this is
listening to you, Prime Minister, it would seem that people should not have too many worries, yet they don't seem convinced that things are going very well at all.
I've not said they shouldn't have worries at all. What I am asking them to do is to understand the problems and the way in which we are trying to deal with them. That's all I'm asking.
It will seem to many people that from going for all-out growth, you've now slammed the brakes on again.
Look, this is quite untrue, and I've already said so.
But why should people believe that this particular package is a solution to our long-term economic problems? We have crisis after crisis, it seems, on the economic front. There's a good deal of cynicism in the country, isn't there?
This is gross exaggeration.
Don't you find cynicism in the country, Prime Minister, about economics and how we get out of the economic problems and how we get out of
them? I've seen a great deal of the country over these past 2 months, 2.5 months in particular. I've always seen a great deal of this country, and I think in the last 2.5 months I've seen more of it than any other politician in this country. And broadly speaking, I do not find cynicism. I find that people want to know what the problems are, and they want to know what is being done to deal with them. And they are, on the whole, fair-minded, and they are perfectly prepared, if it is explained to them, as I've been trying to do in talking to you tonight, what the problems are, what the sources of them are. The British will face up to them, and they will be fair in their treatment of them. Now, I think, as a nation, it is true to say that when we find ourselves up against it, all our best qualities come out. What I want to see is that when we've got the opportunities, that our good qualities come out as well. There's no doubt today about the opportunities. the opportunities in the export markets, the opportunities for meeting the home market, the opportunities for continuing growth. Last year, our production went up by 10%. That is success. The output per man went up by 8.5%. That is success. The opportunities are all there for us, but what we have to do is to seize them, in other words, do what I said 2 years ago, run our affairs in a sensible way. And every time we have some industrial unrest, we lose production. We're not helping ourselves, we're just failing to seize an opportunity. And we've done our utmost over these past 2 years to try to find this reasonable way of settling our differences, to work it out with unions and to work it out with employers. Now, surely, as a nation, we can seize these opportunities which are there now. If industrial unrest disappears, our production will go up, our exports will meet the demand which we have for our imports, and then the whole problem of interest rates comes into perspective and so on, confidence returns. You know, the pound has been strengthening over these last few weeks, it's been getting stronger. We've seen it in the United States, which had very great problems only a short time ago. They are coming through their problems. The dollar is strengthening. Well, let the British nation as a whole now seize these opportunities. Let us run our affairs sensibly.
Prime Minister, thank you.